We've been studying most recently the reign of King Hezekiah, and there have been wonderful things to learn about Hezekiah and his wife Hephzibah. And I think one of the grander things to learn has been Hezekiah's heart for the Lord. And it is intriguing that there are two great takeaways that I've received from Hezekiah's life. And that was Hezekiah's prayer, the prayer of Hezekiah to lay out the letter of his enemy before the altar of the Lord. And then secondly, when prophesied, you could say, I guess, prophesied against by Isaiah concerning this horrible boil on his leg, then came the cry of Hezekiah. And as Christians, there are certainly times when faced with our enemies' edicts, or even curses against you, there are times when it is important for us, like Hezekiah, to come to the altar of the Lord and lay out our woes before Him. And not thinking in terms that God doesn't know what's going on in our life. He certainly does. But the Lord loves a broken and contrite heart. And I will say that there are many times or scenarios that the Lord even orchestrates for the purpose of breaking your heart and bringing it in contrition to His throne. This is what He wants. It's sweeter to Him than any burnt sacrifice. God wants your heart to come in praise and sweetly request that He would come to your aid. Such was the prayer of Hezekiah. And then secondly, we discovered just last week, with respect to Hezekiah's boil, which happened in the 14th year of his reign. We know that this probably happened either just previous to the Assyrian army coming or right afterward. And you know, doctors will say, oftentimes tremendous stress can put your body in a condition where you are open to infection. And many people in very stressful positions or very stressful jobs have fairly significant health challenges. Such was Hezekiah when Isaiah showed up in the palace and said to Isaiah, God said you're going to die. And I think at that point Hezekiah probably could have said, well, duh, we're all going to die. But more specifically, you're going to die from this boil. It seems as though, or we might surmise from the language that Hezekiah says concerning his condition, that it was on his leg, he was incapable of moving, and likely also declared unclean by the priest to be able to come into the house of the Lord because of this ulcerous wound, which apparently was something that was life-threatening, systemic at some point. And you know what? Maybe you've been faced with something like that before. I remember in Israel once, in a hotel, I met another Calvary pastor there, and I said, well, so at that point in Tiberias, you know, they're going out for one of three things. Either go up to the Golan, they're going to go around the lake, or they're getting prepared to head down the Jordan Valley. And I said, so what direction are you heading today? And he said, I'm not going anywhere. I said, why? And he lifted the leg of his jeans, and there was this gaping hole in his leg. I said, what happened? He said, well, you know, I went and saw a doctor here in Tiberias, and he said, you got to go home. This is really serious. You've got to go home and get some attention to this because it appears as though it has MRSA at this point, which is an infection that is nearly uncontrollable. So we prayed over him, and he left. He went back to the States, and his group was then left to one of his associate pastors that were with him on his trip. And I thought, you know what, Lord? These are the kind of situations that we find ourselves in at times. We're in a foreign country, or maybe just out of the blue, you're faced with a situation that seems almost uncontrollable. There really isn't an answer either from a CPA or a medical personnel. Or you're just faced with something that is daunting and something that nobody seems to have an answer for it. These are the situations, honestly, that we need to just lay down before the Lord at his altar and cry out as Hezekiah did. And then when Isaiah said, you're going to die, Hezekiah turned in his bed towards the wall. And he began to cry out to the Lord. And the Lord said to Isaiah before he had left Hezekiah, even for 5 minutes, go right back in there and tell Hezekiah, I've heard your prayer and I have seen your tears. Friends, what we can learn from Hezekiah's prayer life is that he was serious to pray. And oftentimes we can be faced with phenomenal catastrophes like Hezekiah was. But God wants us to be in the mode of prayer, the attitude of prayer, like Hezekiah, all day long. To pray without ceasing, to rejoice always, to give thanks to the Lord for it, in everything that we face. And here we discover that in Hezekiah's life, he was exempling the kind of life that wanted to, as regularly as possible, show his family that this is what we must do. We need to bring these things before God. Now, we went on from there to talk about Manasseh, his son, last week. Now, Manasseh did evil in the sight of the Lord and replaced all the high places and the pagan altars, including the ones in the Valley of Hinnom, where you went to burn your children. He replaced them all that had been taken out by Hezekiah. He put them back into order, hired priests, pagan priests from foreign countries to come and instruct the families of Jerusalem. Now, this is just Jerusalem, just Judah, all that is left after the Assyrians have wiped out the rest of Judah and Benjamin and all of northern Israel. He is instructing the families of Jerusalem, go out here and the priests will instruct you in how to burn your children to receive the benefit, the providence of this pagan god. And there were several different statutes down there that people were instructed to burn their children at. Manasseh also did this to his children. But I want to say that even though Manasseh is considered one of the lengthiest leaders of Judah and by far the most evil of all the leaders of Judah or kings of Judah, there was at one point in his life an event that turned his heart toward home. It's not found in 2 Kings. It's found in the Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 33, verses 10 through 16. I want to read this to you because it's important for you to see something that could be possible for your prodigal children, for your evil employers or employees, for neighbors that vex you, any kind of person that seems just ultimately so evil that he is apart from, you know what, God can't touch this guy. Au contraire, God can, and God often does. Let's look at verse 10 of 2 Chronicles chapter 33, and here the record reports, and the Lord spoke to Manasseh and his people, but they would not listen. What a terrible situation to find yourself in. Therefore the Lord brought upon them the captains of the army of the king of Assyria, who took Manasseh with hooks. In other words, they snagged him with hooks in his skin and drug him off to Assyria. They bound him with bronze fetters and carried him all the way off to Babylon, where the Assyrians were in control of Babylon at this point. Now when he was in affliction, he implored the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers. And he prayed to the Lord, and he received his entreaty, heard his supplication, and brought him back to Jerusalem into his kingdom. Then, note the last sentence in verse 13, then Manasseh knew that the Lord, Jehovah, was God. Now, earlier in his life, he had the opportunity to praise the Lord God because he had been instructed in such a manner by his father, Hezekiah. He recognized that when Hezekiah was in a difficult situation, Hezekiah implored, entreated the Lord God, Jehovah, as well, and God listened, even counted the number of his tears when he was gravely ill with his boil. And God confirmed his favor towards Hezekiah to the prophet Isaiah. But interestingly enough, Josephus, a first century historian for the Jews, records that Jews in their traditions believed that it was Manasseh during the midst of his horrifying reign who took Isaiah and sawed him in two in the hollow of a log publicly in the streets of Jerusalem. That's tradition. We do suspect that Isaiah came to his end this way. It's recorded that some prophet died in that manner in Hebrews chapter 11. But then I love this. God moved in Manasseh's life. Now, God moves, I think, in everyone's life. I think God's perfect methodology, or the way God moves, is in unbelievers to bring them to the recognition of their sin and the desperate necessity to be saved from that sin, because the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of Christ Jesus is eternal life. So God moves in unbelievers for them to recognize that, you know, they're really a pretty bad person. And what can I do with this horrible, wretched soul that I have? And hopefully there are the preachers in the streets of Santa Maria, neighbors that have lived godly lives, that they can turn to and say, well, you know what? My neighbor doesn't have the issues I do. But it seems when catastrophe hits his life, he goes straight to church and God always seems to answer him. I'll go to him. I remember the very first time that I recognized that God moved in my life. I was very sincerely a wretched sinner, very sincerely an angry, horrifying young man on the border of Italy and France in the summer of 1972. And after some events that occurred, I found myself on the border by myself. My two friends had gone on the train to Marseille in France, and I was stuck on the border without a passport and no way to cross the border. I was arrested at the border by the Italian border control, you know, Homeland Security. They arrested me there, and because I had no identification on me, they would not allow me to proceed and get on a train. Had no money, Eurail pass, nothing, to get on a train and meet my two drunken friends in the city of Marseille. No cell phones, no way to contact them. Somehow, they never connected the dots that, gee, we've been in this city for almost a day, and where's Paul? They didn't think of that at all. There I am in a cell on the border of Italy and France. And I remember asking God, because there was nothing left. It was around midnight when the shift change occurred at that border station. And the new captain of the guard came in and he walked to where I was seated and he said, "What are you doing here? You're from America, aren't you?" Perfect English. No one else prior in that day could speak English or well enough where they could understand me or I could understand them. I said, "Well, here's the situation. I'm stuck here, don't have any money, don't have my passport, no Eurail pass, I've got nothing." He said, "Well, where is all the stuff that you need?" I said, "It's in my backpack with my two friends in Marseille." He said, "Well, do you have anything to identify yourself as an American?" I said, "Well, other than the fact that I've got, you know, this California surfer drawl, that's about it." He said, "Come with me." And he walked me to the train, He talked to the conductor, something in Italian. He sat me in a seat and he said, "Do not move." He says, "Do not move until you get to Marseille. And then you're the French's problem." You don't want to have problems in France. And you know what? On the train ride, I recognized for the first time in my life that God had moved. God had heard my cry. He had seen my tears. And for the first time in my life, I praised the God that had saved me. I didn't know his name. I didn't even know whose name to speak. I just thanked the Lord, and I remember that as the first time that I thanked the Lord. I actually thanked him as I lay on the carpet. I just fell down from my seat onto the carpet and just started thanking God that he had done this in my life. Never forgotten that. And so it was for Manasseh, that Manasseh knew that the Lord was God. Maybe you have a prodigal child this morning. Maybe you have a relative. Maybe you have a friend. And we should have friends that do not know Jesus. Jesus was often found among the sinners and the publicans. It's good to be acquainted with, to be friends with those that do not know Jesus, so that they can see Jesus in you. You see that? Because there's going to come a point in their life when catastrophe will happen. It happens in everyone's life. And if they know that you love the Lord God and you're a person that prays, you're a person that cries out at the altar of the Lord, they're going to know that it's safe to bring their catastrophe to you so that you would pray before the Lord. And when God answers them, you can point them to the God, speak of his name that has come to their aid. So it was with Manasseh in the city of Babylon. Does God go to Babylon? Yes, he does. Does God go to Fresno? Yes, he does. God is everywhere, and he is looking into the hearts of believers and non-believers, looking for that opportunity. God desires that none would perish, friends. And if you're a Christian this morning, it's because God didn't want you to perish eternally, that he sent his Holy Spirit to draw you to the cross, you see. Maybe it was in a catastrophe in your life. It was in my life. Maybe it was at a point where there just really wasn't any return. Maybe it was just you found yourself in a church one morning and suddenly the Spirit of God fell upon you and you realized, I've got to do something about my sinful nature. So it was with Manasseh. He was at the end of his rope. He's in a jail with bronze fetters on his legs, far from home, far from his position as a king, far from the delicacies of his palace. And he cries out to the Lord, "I now know that you are the Lord God." See, friends, that's all it takes. If you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth that Christ is risen from the dead, Peter said, you are saved. On the basis of that, dear friends, isn't it rather simple to tell people, listen, just believe that Jesus rose from the dead, that his resurrection is real. Believe in your heart, confess it with your mouth, and you're saved. See, that's why we're here. That's why we're here this morning. To be enlivened, to be encouraged, to be motivated, to be exhorted, to go out and to touch the lives that are lost in this world. Because, friend, I'm guessing someone touched your life when you were lost. Someone touched my life when I was lost. Someone took at least some effort to speak into my heart, a wretched and horrible young man, and to point me to Jesus. That's probably why you're here as well. No one prayed me into the kingdom except the Holy Spirit. That's our ministry. I am so excited about this week. I really am. And I'll tell you why. I've had several wonderful meetings with several pastors in this community that really are looking for revival in this community. are excited about revival, and here's what we're going to do. And if you're up at 6 a.m. on Wednesday morning, I would like you to pray from where you are for the pastors. There's seven of us that are going to be in to meet at 6 a.m. every Wednesday morning to pray that Jesus would come into the streets of Santa Maria. I truly do believe that God wants to pour out His Spirit on this community. There have been so many prophetic words concerning this city that it has at least encouraged me to believe that God wants to do something that only He can do. You see, it's up to the Lord. But we're going to bang on His door. I'm going to pound on His altar. You know, often people will say, it's the push prayer. Ever heard that before? Push prayer, P-U-S-H. Pray until something happens. And that's what we're going to do. 6 a.m. this Wednesday and every Wednesday after that. People, I truly do believe the streets of Santa Maria are going to be affected. Problem with the people in Jerusalem, because of Manasseh and reigning for some 50 years, was that they had been reconditioned, apart from Hezekiah, to now put their faith in pagan gods. Enough faith that they would burn their own children for these pagan gods' favor. And here's what ends up happening, is that you begin to have three classes of people within a community, and such is also true in this community. Back in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 21, Elijah came to all the people and said, "How long will you falter between two opinions?" And he said, "If the Lord is God, follow Him. But if Baal, follow him." And the people answered him not a word. 1 Kings 18, verse 21. You see, what Elijah discovered about that encounter at the OK Corral at Carmel is what we're encountering in this community, if not encountering in every community in the world, is that you have those that truly are devoted servants of the Lord. In this case, it was only Elijah. And then you have those who are decided servants of the devil. They're proud of their evil lifestyles. They're proud of their corrupt mindsets. And then you have those, which were the vast majority of this situation in 1 Kings, and the vast majority of our situation in this community, that have never made a decision either way. It's not as though they're teetering on the fence with respect to either Jesus or the devil. That's the only two choices, friends. I just want you to know. There's only two choices in this world. The Lord God of all heaven and earth, the lover of your souls, and He who hates your souls and wants to drag men and women to hell for eternity with Him. He's that angry. And the vast majority of people in any community, if not in this world, are people who perhaps don't have any religious basis, either Hinduism or Tao or Mormonism or whatever it is. They're not so much compelled by an ism, but compelled by humanism, I suppose. They've never made a choice, and so they're not decided either way. And Elijah said, but the people answered him not a word. The vast majority of the people that came to that event, 450 prophets of Baal, one prophet of the Lord God, Jehovah, and the showdown ended up proving that there was one person among the great populace that was right in his choice. And I want to ask you this morning, you know, I didn't come to Jesus because fire fell from heaven. I didn't come to Jesus because someone did some hat trick or a phenomenal sign and wonder. I came to Jesus because I found that my life was in a catastrophe, and there was only one answer provided, which I could see fruit in other people's lives. That was Jesus. Oh, I've been around religious people my whole life. Gone to church or forced to go to church my whole life. I even had a Bible that I got from graduating Sunday school. I never knew where it was. I had my name on it, but I got rid of it quickly. The Holy Spirit moved on this poor soul, and I was changed eternally. Friends, here's the point I'm trying to make this morning. Most of the people that you would encounter on a daily basis are people that are simply, by their own volition, by their own mindset, by their own decision, never made a choice with respect to Jesus. Oh, they got the catastrophes you do. They got the challenges you do, but they really don't know where exactly to take them. And watching your life will persuade them or tilt the balance enough, perhaps, for them to choose Jesus. And this is what I'm asking you this morning. As in Elijah's day, so also in your day, you could be the only prophet of the Lord God, Jehovah, in your workplace, in your neighborhood, in your family. And I've heard of people this way. For many years, I was the only one saved by the blood of Jesus in the Berry family. And you know what? Praise God, I didn't shrink from that calling. And it came at great cost. And in my family, only my youngest sister has come to know the Lord Jesus, and she loves him desperately. What's the cost? What's the cost that you must pay? Well, friends, you've got to be real. You've got to live for Jesus. You've got to be an example. You've got to be the walking, living epistle that Paul described the church, some in the church of Corinth, to be. The living word. And then when people find themselves in a tough situation, they can turn to you and say, you know, here's what's going on. Hey, let's take it to prayer right now. Don't say, I'll pray for this, and maybe then you won't. But stand there with them and pray for them right there and then. And then you know that when God brings about the change, he will get the glory. And it could be sufficient. It could be the tipping of the balance to bring them to Jesus forever and ever. Friends, this is what I'm asking in Santa Maria. You know what? Without Jesus, it's tough to live anywhere. With Jesus, at least you've got some place to lay the letter of your enemies, some place to speak the name of Jesus when you've got that boil or something else. The truth of Manasseh is that he saw in his father's life that when catastrophe occurred, he could turn to the Lord. And so Manasseh did in the jail of Babylon. He turned to the Lord and he said he knew that the Lord was God. And after this, verse 14 of 2 Chronicles chapter 33, after this he built a wall outside the city of David on the west side of Gihon in the valley as far as the entrance of the fish gate, and it enclosed Ophel. And he raised it to a very great height. Then he put military captains in all the fortified cities of Judah. He took away the foreign gods and the idol from the house of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And all the altars that he had built in the mount of the house of the Lord and in Jerusalem. And he cast them out of the city. He also repaired the altar of the Lord, sacrificed peace offerings and thank offerings on it, and commanded Judah to serve the Lord God of Israel. Friends, what happens when you encounter Jesus? Everything in life changes because the old man has been put away. A new man has been put on. And friends, if you're a Christian and the old man is still exhibiting himself, let's get back to the cross. Let's get back to the altar. Let's get back to a place at this altar today to make sure our life is the exhibition of God's grace, of his mercy. Note, please, that this evil man was met with a confounding and oftentimes an amazing grace of God, because God loved Manasseh even in the midst of his evil. God loved Manasseh even when he was sacrificing his children. God loves you even if you're at the abortion clinic, even if you're sitting in Elmer's, even if, like me, stood on a beach in Florida and shook my fist at heaven And I cursed the living God, only to discover in 3 months that Jesus loved me so confoundly that I could only ask him to be my Savior. There are many people today who have not made a decision, have not chosen, as Elijah said, who the Lord God is. And perhaps in their life they are teetering at that point where they could fall either way. And friends, you have been sent. You are the light in the midst of darkness, salt in the midst of a horrifying wound in this world. You have been sent for such a time as this to preach the gospel in the streets of Santa Maria. And I'll have to say, you know, I consider myself a Pentecostal. And the problem with Pentecostals is this. We love to pray, but we don't go and preach. We'll spend a lot of time praying, but to move from prayer to action is very difficult oftentimes with Pentecostals. And friends, we're starting a season when all are going to be called to go, to preach, to stand, to live the Word of God. This is the only way the streets of Santa Maria are going to be changed. I guarantee you, this is the only way Jesus is going to save this community. I know you're with me. So we pick up now in 2 Kings chapter 21, verse 19, the son of Manasseh has not learned anything, has chosen not to learn anything from the repentance of his father. Wow. And it could happen. Ammon was 22 years old when he became king, and he reigned 2 years in Jerusalem, one of the shortest reigns in Judah. His mother's name was Meshulemeth, the daughter of Harus of Jotbah. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord, as his father Manasseh had done. So he walked in all the ways that his father had walked, and he served the idols that his father had served and worshipped then. And he forsook the Lord God of his fathers and did not walk in the way of the Lord. Now that's really the history of Ammon's reign. It was only 2 years long, but noting what we saw in 2 Chronicles chapter 33, after Manasseh had returned from Babylon and gotten rid of all the idols, it seems as though Ammon made sure that those idols were replaced and worshipped by the community of Jerusalem. Interesting when a son doesn't learn from his father. And we're all learning. You know that, don't you? You're either learning what you will do or what you won't do, particularly from your parents. You might even have a list in your life where I'm going to be just like my dad in this area, or I am never going to be like this concerning my father. And Ammon saw the life of Manasseh. Doesn't say that in 2 Kings. Does say that in 2 Chronicles, and he just chose to ignore that. Maybe he saw this as cowardice or weakness in Manasseh's life, when in fact coming to know Jesus is one of the greatest strengths there can be in a man's life. A true man, a macho man, loves Jesus. Remember a t-shirt back in the days of Promise Keepers, and the t-shirt had in bold letters, "Real men worship loud." I loved that. And in those days of the Promise Keepers, stadiums would be filled with men crying out the name of Jesus. It was such a good thing. Benjamin Franklin said, "We are all born ignorant, but one must work hard to remain stupid." Boy, ain't that the truth. We're all born ignorant, but you got to work pretty hard to remain stupid. Simply not choosing to learn. And many people are that way. Verse 23 of 2 Kings chapter 21. Then the servants of Ammon conspired against him and killed the king in his own house. And the people of the land executed all those who had conspired against King Ammon. Then the people of the land made his son Josiah king in his place. Now, what's interesting to me is that Ammon was likely sleeping in the very bed that his grandfather turned and worshiped the living God in his horrifying situation. And God said to the prophet, I have heard your prayer, and I have counted your tears, and I have come immediately to your aid. Friends, now Ammon doesn't care. Ammon has excluded the possibility of God coming to his aid. Now, that doesn't mean that God didn't love Ammon. He did. God provided for Ammon, just as he did for Manasseh, an opportunity to turn his heart towards the Lord. So he does also for you. Don't think for an instant, particularly in America, that someone you've met really has never heard about Jesus at all. I think that would be rather rare. There was one occasion when Lucy and I, on Sunday afternoons, would go to the local park in Hanford, California, where we lived, and we would speak to drunks. And we actually met a man. He was in his late 60s. And we were sitting next to him. He was fairly inebriated. And I said, have you ever heard of Jesus in your life? And he said, honestly, I haven't. Well, I've heard his name, but I don't know anything about him. I said, oh, this is great. And so we preached the gospel. He received Jesus as a Savior. Lucy and I pastored a church in the morning and a different church in the evening on Sundays, invited him to church. He never showed up. But I know that Jesus showed up in the park that afternoon. It is possible that someone may not know Jesus, but expect that they would, and preach the gospel of Christ, the gospel of peace. And all the people of the land executed all those who had conspired against King Ammon. Then the people of the land made his son Josiah king in his place. Now, the rest of the acts of Ammon, which he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Judah? We just looked at that just a moment ago. And he was buried in his tomb in the garden of Uzzah when Josiah his son reigned in his place. Now, that's really nothing remarkable outside of what you've already read concerning Ammon. No place where he turned his heart towards home. No place where he recognized that God was speaking into his heart. And what a horrible testimony. What a terrible memorial service that must have been. Because he refused to turn to God like his father did. Refused to turn to God like his grandfather did. What excuse do you have? I don't know what there could be. Maybe this morning you would consider yourself as someone who is living a fairly godly life. Oh, there's places you could improve in holiness with regard to the Lord. But perhaps you have a child this morning. Perhaps you have a cousin, you have an uncle, you have somebody like a nephew or a niece who do not know Jesus, or at least are not living a lifestyle that would be representative of Jesus as the living epistle. And friends, irrespective of all the times you've spoken into their lives, actually prayed with them. You see, as long as they are breathing air, there is this opportunity that God provides, this crossroad in their life to receive Jesus as their Savior. Don't give up praying for them. Don't give up speaking the cross of Christ to them. Because it could be at that last moment in the emergency room, could be at that last moment when the airbag has gone off and they're losing their grip on life, that they remember Uncle Joe. They remember your preaching in their hearts. And in that desperate, faint moment, speak the name of Jesus. Believe that he indeed was raised from the dead. Speak it with their mouths. Confess his name, and thereby find you in heaven one of these days. That's the way God is. And so Josiah was 8 years old when he became king, starting in chapter 22. We're just looking at the first two verses here, because I want to start this testimony with regard to Josiah in such a way that you recognize that it doesn't matter what age you are. You can speak to children, you can speak to adults, you can speak to old people, you can speak to young people. And to see what they want to recognize is that Jesus has made a difference in your life. And you know what? Your life is a testimony. your life should be representative of Jesus changing you because of his blood, because of his Holy Spirit, because of the fire of the Holy Ghost, you know, removing the dross from your heart. Here's what happens. Josiah was 8 years old when he became king. Now, he wasn't the youngest of the kings in Judah. We read of Joash in 2 Kings 11, who was 7. And then, of course, Manasseh was 12 when he became king. Now, I can't imagine. At Vacation Bible School, I asked the 8-year-olds, what if you were king of a nation right now? And they're like, oh, that'd be so cool. We could eat ice cream all day long. Yeah. Until you hate ice cream. I mean, you know, ask people that work in an ice cream shop, how much do you love ice cream? And they're like, oh, Lord. I go home smelling like ice cream. This is the way my son was when he worked at Starbucks. He came home smelling like an old pot of coffee. Josiah was just 8 years old. Scripture tells us that two particular important events occurred in Josiah's life. At the age of 7, at the age of 16, Josiah rededicated his life to the Lord. In those first 8 years as a king, I think there was probably a huge learning curve, a lot for Josiah to speed up with, but we recognize in 2 Chronicles that Josiah came to an event in his life where he decided that day, at the age of 16, that I'm going to serve the Lord all the days of my life. And I will not wander either to the right or to the left from my encounter with Christ. And this is what I pray for our young people today. Did you know that most revivals start with the youth, with young people? Most revivals start with young people. And there's no reason to believe that it won't start again with the young people in our community. I remember standing in the youth group room at Moriah Chapel in Wales. I was speaking with a pastor, current pastor there, about what happened when the Welsh revival struck the coal mines and the pubs and the cities of Wales. And he said, history tells us that there was a particular night when the youth had come back from an event and they were gathered in the youth group room. And one of the young girls began to cry out for the Lord Jesus to come and save her, to wash her, to forgive her of her sins. She fell on the wooden floor and began to cry out with crying. The other youth, being impacted by what the Holy Spirit was doing at that time, fell down on their faces and began to cry out to the Lord. This went on for hours. Late into the evening, families were wondering where their children were. Knowing that they had gone to a youth ministry at Moriah Chapel in their town, dads left their homes and walked to Moriah Chapel. And entering into the youth group room on that wooden floor where I stood that day, the fathers were hit hard by the Holy Ghost. They saw their children repenting and crying out for Jesus, and they fell on their faces as well. Soon, the police officers were called. Our kids and now our fathers are missing. Where are they? They went to Moriah Chapel, and the police officers, as it was in the days of William Seymour in 1904 in Azusa, the police officers were hit by the Holy Spirit and could not leave. Fathers did not go to their mines to work the following morning. This revival went on for weeks. Pubs closed because of lack of business. Mines closed. In fact, it is said that at the outcome of this revival, the ponies that pulled the carts of coal in the coal mines would no longer respond to the coal miners because the coal miners would no longer curse at the ponies. The ponies did not know what had changed about these miners, but they had utterly been changed by the Holy Ghost. And friends, when revival hits the streets of Santa Maria, I believe this is what it's going to look like. I believe that we're going to see a change in the youth of America, in the youth of Santa Maria. I believe crossing racial lines, culture lines, all manner of lines that divide us today, there are going to be people who are impacted through their children with respect to the Spirit of the living God. I'm not saying if revival hits Santa Maria. I'm saying when revival hits Santa Maria. Friends, this whole community is going to change. Elmer's is going to close their doors. Imagine that. No more people getting shot at Elmore's. Coachman, dark hole in the earth that that place is. Louis B's, terrifying spiritual hellhole that that pub is. Closing. Can you imagine that? And people coming to worship, not spending their half an hour with the Lord, but coming to worship all day long. Police officers looking for missing children and finding them in church, and those police officers being ruined by the Holy Spirit's presence. Can you imagine that? I dream of this. I think about this so often. I remember, we have just a few minutes left, but I'm actually going to close here pretty quick. Don't worry. I remember many years ago when Lucy and I were living in Hanford, California, over in the Central Valley. Before, I was pastoring two different churches. Lucy and I were very busy in ministry. Lucy was a director in a preschool. I had a pool cleaning business. I taught at two different prisons in the Central Valley, as well as pastoring two different churches. And I remember one night having this dream about a high school stadium and a stage on that stadium with people worshiping, people falling down before the living God. The Word of God going out from that stadium and touching the entire city. Now, we lived across the street from Hanford High School Stadium. It wasn't that stadium. It wasn't until I moved to Santa Maria that I recognized what stadium it was. Santa Maria High School Stadium. And I believe, I'm praying. You know, prophecy is one thing, but it needs to motivate believers, not in the prophecy, but believers in what the Spirit of God is capable of doing. It needs to motivate people to action, okay? Thinking something is one thing. Doing something is completely different. And that's how a city has changed. Doers, not just hearers. But I believe one of these days, soon, and I pray soon, we're going to have an event at the Santa Maria High School. There's going to be pastors from many different denominations that love the Lord Jesus together, that have been praying earnestly, fasting for this city. And we're going to see this city, and I'm going to put it in this terms, we're going to see this city ruined for Jesus, okay? Ruined for Jesus. It can happen. And at age 16, Josiah rededicated his life to the Lord. And at the age of 20, he changed Judah for Christ. I'll put it in those terms. Yes, young people can change the course of a community.